at Hanauma Bay. In this first year, we really focused on this inner reef flat of Hanauma Bay and how that relates to visitor use, what we're seeing there, how the lab that I work in set up monitoring sites outside of the reef. So we'll talk a little bit more about these coral reef assessment and monitoring program sites at the end of the talk, or near the end of the talk. What we want to know is, are these restrictions working? And what we did is, in this first year of the biological carrying capacity study, we tried to ask questions to look at what are the acceptable limits of disturbance to Hanauma Bay. What are we seeing with the visitor counts that are happening right now? So we broke this into three tasks. We first compiled all the historical literature that was performed in Hanauma Bay. We tried to dissect it, see what has been done before, what hasn't been done before, and what we should be looking at if there were any holes in the literature. After we did that, we performed human counts. We wanted to see where people were going in the bay and what they were doing there. We coupled these human counts with what we call direct human impact monitoring. So we wanted to look at coral trampling, whether people were coral trampling where they were. We wanted to look at whether or not they were stirring up the sediment. And then we also looked at the benthic structure of the reef. So what are the corals that are currently living there doing? How are they surviving? Throughout the talk, I'll be talking about Hanauma Bay, so I want to make sure everyone is familiar with our different sectors of the bay. So for this first year, we were looking at this inner reef flat, because that really is where the most visitors hang out, and that's also where they can stand. So we broke it into back doors, people, channel, which is through inshore, and then offshore. A lot of this offshore site is what we use for our controls, since it is too deep for anyone to stand. If there's disturbance out there, it's likely due to things like wave action or fish bites, something like that. So it's a really good control area. Within each of these sectors, we placed two transects that were 5 meters by 15 meters in length. These transects were actually established during the 2015-16 bleaching event, so we have data on them prior to this study being performed, so that's very helpful. We looked at these human counts. That was our first step, because we wanted to quantify where people were. So we did this by time-lapse hourly photos on the hour every day for the 30 days. So we did this two sets of 30 days, 30 days in June and 30 days in October. We set out these time-lapse photos, but we also surveyed on 10 randomly selected non-Tuesdays. We did a visual count. So counting how many people were in each area at what time. Our times were 8, 11, and 2. And then at the same time, we looked at things like coral trampling and supplementation, which we'll talk about. So what are visitors doing in Lent? The majority of our visitors, we can see here, are on the beach, 41%. So they're not even going in the water at the time they aren't in the water. And we can see that the majority of them are here in people in channel at around 11 a.m. So that's interesting, but what we want to know is, what are they doing when they're in the water? Where is everyone snorkeling? The majority, 50%, are snorkeling in people area, and about 40% in channel, and then around 5 in back doors, and 3-ish in boats, which is through an offshore. So what we now did is we took all those values that we're finding, and we could say how much coral trampling was in people, which had 50% of the snorkelers and waders in that area. So now we'll talk about our coral trampling experiment. For this experiment, we had 70 total coral skeletons that we placed out on the reef. We placed 7 in each transect, and we did semi-daily swims to document their presence and absence. Are they there or are they not there? And then we took top-down weekly photos on Tuesdays to calculate percent loss over time. Here is one example, or two examples, of how we measure the skeleton. Here, you can see this skeleton is found in people sector. This one is in witches' brew sector. So before we go through the 5 weeks that they were out here, just keep in mind that people had about 50% of our snorkelers and waders, and witches' brew had around 3%.
What is a skeleton?
A coral skeleton, right?
Oh.
Good question, yeah. So a coral skeleton. It's basically a skeleton that we had used in a prior experiment for a control in the lab. And so you'll see kind of that they are pinkish in color here. So when we use these corals in the lab, what we'll do is we'll check their growth rates. So we first dye them with this pink dye, and then at the end of the experiment, we have to sacrifice them to see how much they've calcified or grown. So we took all the controls from that experiment and used them in this trampling experiment since we could not use live corals. So that's what I'm referring to. Thank you. So we would take these on Tuesdays, I'd bring them back to the lab and take their top-down area. That's week one. There's week two, and you can see that keyhole already has somewhere around 40% loss of its skeleton, while the one in which it's brewed looks pretty intact. We go to week three, and it's even smaller. And this continues for week four and five, so it kind of has a big loss in the beginning and then hits a stable point. So maybe the point that it's at is too low in the water column or in a hole, so it's not getting broken anymore when people are stepping, we don't know. But this trend holds true for all of Hanauma Bay. We see that keyhole and channel here, we have both our June and our October values for both studies, and here on the y-axis we have percent loss of skeletons per day. And so we can see that our highest loss sectors are here at backdoors, keyhole, and channel, while witches grew and offshore don't have as much loss of skeleton. Another thing that was interesting is that the highest whole colony loss was observed in well, there was no whole colony loss in witches brew or offshore. So what this means is, by the second week, in keyhole, we would swim and we put out 7 skeletons, we were sure of it, but maybe there were only 3 left. So entire loss of skeletons. None of that was observed in witches brew or offshore, which has the low impact of visitors. Here, we have another graph showing on the y-axis average percent skeletal loss per day. And then here we have average percent swimmers and waders. So what we're trying to do here is correlate the amount of swimmers and waders to the loss.
How do you measure your skeleton?
With zip ties. With zip ties. Yes.
Zip ties still in?
No, the zip ties have been removed. Everything has been removed from this study. Not to worry. So here what we notice is that as swimming and wading increases, so as we move right on those graphs, we see an increase in coral trampling, or an increase in loss of coral skeleton in both June and October. Another thing that we looked at was water clarity. This is really important for corals to survive because they need clear water to utilize the light to create their own food. So we wanted to look at water clarity. What we did is we used a secchi disc method. The traditional secchi disc method is vertical. So you're dropping this disc down into the water column, and once you can no longer see it, you record that value. And then you can pull it on up and you record it again once you see it. So you have two observations. Since Hanauma Bay is so shallow, we decided to do this horizontally. So what we did is we went over the transect and swam the secchi disc out until we could no longer see it, and then recorded those values. And we did this right after the 11 a.m. visual count. So we knew exactly how many people were in the water and we would go out and report the value of the water clarity. We also had to report things like time of day, which we knew was after 11, the cloud cover, wave height, and other environmental issues, conditions, because with higher wave action, we get more sediment in the water column, so that wouldn't have to do with the number of whiskers in the water. We wanted to make sure we had all of our parameters covered. Here on this graph, we have visual secchi distance here. And what's interesting about secchi distance is that you want this to be long. The longer this secchi distance is, the longer your visual distance is, the clearer the water. So what we notice here is that these black bars refer to open days, so when visitors are present. These whiter or lighter bars refer to closed days, when visitors are not present. So here we're seeing that in every single sector, on open days, we have less visual distance than we do on our closed days. And that was actually 30%, approximately 30% clearer on our closed days. Yes?
Can you tell me how much of that is due to the people stirring up the sand? How much is natural?
We're gonna talk about that also, yeah. So, yeah, it has to do a lot with how many people are in the area, so stirring up that sand, but also having to do with tidal flux. So like you're talking about the environmental parameters. Let's say it's a super high and a super low, then we're gonna have a lot more water shifting around and we can get murkier water. Or if the wind speed is really high or in a different direction than usual, you can also get more stirring up of water if wave height is higher. So we wanted to look exactly at that, how much of this is due to humans. So first we did the water clarity, and to add on to that, we also did our sediment trap accumulation. What we did here is we placed out these tubes along the transects, one at the beginning and one at the end, and we left them out for approximately 30 days. Approximately, in case they swam off on their own and had to be replaced. And in that case, it was standardized to the amount of days that it was in the field. Here we have these figures. And what you're going to notice is the sectors are in different colors. The colors refer to the amount of visitor pressure in each area. So green is very light pressure. Yellow and orange could be intermediate, so you're seeing that more in channel area. And then red here in people. And then you see these dots in every sector. The dots go from small to large, telling us how much sediment accumulation was happening. So large dots mean less sediment, large dark dots mean a lot of sediment, and small light colored dots mean not so much sediment. So what you can see here is that June and October are variable, they're not the same. So we do have different sediment regimes going on with what the weather patterns are, so that's good to know. But we also see a lot of sediment accumulation in those sectors that are colored in red, so here in people. And we did find a significant correlation between proportion of visitors swimming and wading in each area and the sediment.
I see a large black dot, but I can't read the key to it, the legend, or what that means.
It means around 8 grams of sediment per day. A lot of water. Yeah.
Before you go on, I have a question about Witch's Brew.
Yeah.
The Secchi disc had the lowest readings.
Yeah.
But the sediment is also low. How do you explain that?
It could be that it's more turbulent in Witch's Brew area, so the water, the waves are keeping the sediment more suspended versus it depositing onto the reef flat. So we're kind of looking at two different things. The Secchi disc, it tells us how much sediment is in the water column, possibly affecting the photosynthesis of live corals, and what this is telling us is how much sediment is accumulating on the sediment or on the surface of the reef. So this is telling us whether or not there's possibly some smothering going on in corals, if it's depositing and smothering corals, or even if it's sand, if it's large particulate sand, then it could even be scraping the corals. So that's what sediment accumulation is really asking or telling us. After this, we took coral colony surveys within all of these transects, and we documented size, coverage of corals, coral species, growth and orientation, partial mortality, any new breakage, disease, feeding scars, and rugosity. So one that you may not be familiar with here is rugosity. So what that is it's spatial complexity of the reef. You're looking at how many nooks and crannies are in the reef. This might be good habitat for more fish. This is often associated with higher biodiversity of fishes and corals having higher rugosity. So we wanted to look at how this differs between transects. First, we'll talk about the coral species found within the bay. We have quite a few coral species. And the most common are our rice and ringed rice corals, and those large colonies are found in channel. I'm sure you think they're familiar. And then we also have our lobe coral and our sandpaper coral that are common in Witch's Brew and back doors in the Keyhole area. And of course our cauliflower corals. So they're more common here in. What we found is that there's high species diversity, however, there is low overall coral cover within the inner reef flat. So looking at the amount of coral cover, here on this graph we have percent coral cover and then all of our transects here. And we can see that backdoors and people have very low coral cover, which is through west has lowish coral cover, but our channel east, west, and which is for east have quite high coral cover. We can attribute the low coral cover of Keyhole to things like human usage, coral breakage, because we saw so much coral breakage in Keyhole in the previous few slides, and then sediment accumulation, which also was really high. That's where we were seeing that 8 grams of sediment. And then in channel, we have the highest rugosity of any of the transects. So what this means is those nooks and crannies, we were finding that corals really like to be on the vertical surfaces, which we'll talk about in a few slides. But here we can see the rugosity, and we have the highest rugosity in channel, well, medium, intermediate rugosity in. And then we have high breakage in Keyhole, high human usage. So we're thinking that the reason why channel has such high coral cover is because of this rugosity and saving grace. But the lowest coral cover was seen in the highest use sectors, and the highest coral cover was seen in intermediate use sectors, but they have really high rugosity. So for our observations, a little bit what I was talking about before, we noticed that all of the corals in the inner reef flat of Hanauma Bay are mounding or encrusting in form. These are really robust skeletal forms, which means that it's possible the more delicate skeletal forms may not be able to live here. So something that might break a little easier may have gotten phased out. And we also saw that orientation was very different. So almost all of our large coral colonies were found in on vertical surfaces like this, or here we have the cauliflower coral, or within cracks. So if you put your foot on that, you probably won't touch the coral. You'll probably just step on the reef flat above the coral. So our corals are growing on vertical substrate that can't be stepped on or within cracks. And the spatial distribution and abundance of corals show a history of human use and an impact of that. The other So looking more toward the outer reef, not so much the inner reef. Our coral reef assessment and monitoring program was established in 1999, and we have sites throughout the main Hawaiian islands that we can compare to. At each of the sites, there are two transects. So we have a shallow and a deep. So these are where they are located, shallow, and then deep out here. And at each of these, there are 10 meter transects, where we look at coral cover richness, diversity, algae, and substrate cover. Here we have coral cover, and then our survey years of the cramp sites. We'll talk about the shallow cramp site first, which is this gray color here. We saw a decline in coral cover at our shallow site until around 2012, and since then it actually has been increasing, which is very exciting. At the deep site, so here in black, we saw a little bit of a increase, and then this large decrease here between our 2012 and 2017 surveys, and that was likely due to the leaching event in 2015 and 2016. So we saw a large decrease in coral cover there, but since then we have seen an increase cover. But as we can see here, median coral cover is still between 15% and 20%, which is on par with the rest of the state. So prior to the bleaching event in 2015, the average coral cover for the state was 24.2% coral cover. These are all of the rest of the cramp sites that are located throughout the state with the blue highlighting MPAs. Marine protected areas. And if anyone has any questions about that, feel free to check our website. There is more information on it. In summary, there's not sufficient evidence to support the statement that declines in coral cover are exclusively the result of reserve presence. However, we have strong supporting evidence that they are a contributing factor. What we noticed is that rates of coral breakage is strongly related to visitor levels in each sector. The greater the number of visitors in a sector, the lower the coral cover. Coral morphologies were conducive to high impact areas. Cramp sites in the areas beyond the sites of trampling, beyond the depths of trampling, showed high coral cover. Water clarity increased on average 30% on days where they were closed, and sedimentation levels were related to the number of visitors. Yes.
Sarah, I had a question about the first sentence. Who postulated that the decline in coral cover are the exclusive result of visitor presence? I mean, why is it, was that the hypothesis of, one of the hypotheses of your study? Or is it just the wording that is kind of, I mean, I can't imagine anybody assuming that it was only because of human use or visitor, because there's so many variables in a marine environment.
Right, I think that we're just trying to tell people that there are other variables responsible.
Okay, so we're just talking about wording in that sentence.
Okay.
Not,
yeah.
Right, so, I mean, nobody, I don't think, would have assumed that it was only due to human use. I mean, right, so.
Right.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure that I could understand the premise of that sentence.
Okay. Yeah.
So, if the most used area in the bay is, you know, the area where there's the least amount of coral, then the people are here to see the fish, not really understanding the coral has been my experience. So how do you explain that? Because that the fish go where the coral is, right? And the food.
Fish
so
have some microscopy, and the outer reef flat have high coral cover, so they'll still remain in the bay.
But it almost seems like you need a fish study,
right? So
to be next alongside of the coral.
That is exactly what we're doing this year.
Okay.
Yeah, I wish we could do everything at one time, yeah. But yeah. So we're working on fish this year. So some of our management recommendations for, at the end of this first year study, were to put TVs in the Sea Grant educational room that had subtitles in common visiting languages. Disperse users among different activities, so maybe a hike along the toilet bowl rim up here, something like that, to get a little more pressure off of your reef, but also be able to see how beautiful today is. And an educational web page that contains resources that visitors can see before they get here, so they can be even more educated once they come here. Another thing that I really, really feel strongly about are these educational signs that are that would be posted along sidewalks and beach to inform everyone about the etiquette of snorkeling. So don't stand unless it's sand. Here in Ahikinau on Maui, they have these really lovely signs that actually tell you where to enter the water, which is awesome. So you're not entering the water right on reef flat. You're entering the water in the sand. Once you get to your knees, you're not supposed to be snorkeling. So having more informational signage like that right where people are getting in. And then also more signage about the research that's going on in Bay. Our next step. So what we're doing in the second year is we are going to be putting out these experimental cages. What we couldn't do in the first year was actually exclude humans, so we built them into the project. We said, okay, how many humans are in this area? We'll look at what the coral cover, what the sedimentation, what the trampoline is like. What we want to do this year is exclude humans completely and look at what does this plot of substrate do without humans? Or what does it do without herbivores? What if it doesn't have fish presence? So we'll be placing exclusion cages out into the bay, which I'll talk a little more about. We've been doing reef fish surveys, and we've also been taking historical data that has been collected by DAR, and we've been looking at correlating that with the amount of people that have been visiting Hanauma Bay throughout the year. And then we'll also be looking into social, physical, and facilities during capacity studies. We all see the reason for a biological pairing capacity study, but the social pairing capacity study is important because that tells you how people are feeling when they're in the bay. Do they feel like they're too close to their neighbor while they're sunbathing or while they're snorkeling? The physical pairing capacity study is likely not going to be the limiting one because that's how many people could you physically fit into Hanauma Bay or on the beach left, on the beach down there. And then the facilities pairing capacity study is, are there enough bathrooms, trash cans, that many facilities, personnel to be able to handle how many people are coming in here every day? So we want to make sure that that is also being taken care of, because it all goes downstream. Yes?
Do you have any results of the previous cage or areas in Hanauma Bay?
I do not. I actually have, so in the first biological pairing capacity study, they did cage off an area. Do you remember that? Yeah, so they caged off a large area here in Keeble. And actually, I think it was right here. And in the results of the biological pairing capacity study, they had not finished that, so they did not add any results of the caging study. So I don't have any of that, but I have methodology, and that's what I'm trying to mirror.
And there are some other smaller cages later on.
Oh, really?
Hopefully
that doesn't happen. So here is a sign of what we're going to be placing out into the bay, or out here for visitors once we have the cages out in the bay. So it says, please keep clear of research zones. We'll have a research zone in each of the main sectors and then one offshore. Here,
have you considered a management of encouraging establishing more marine protected areas that we encourage snorkelers to disperse out to other good places?
In the state?
In Oahu?
On Oahu. I have not. I know that I've talked to the managers of Pupukeo Waimea MK, and and they're also having an overcrowding issue. So I don't know that dispersing people would help. I think the reason, what we think is most helpful would be educating them and really trying to bring, I don't know that we're reaching everyone, because people are coming here from places where there aren't reefs, and most of the time they're not stepping on the reef because they want to, because they want to walk around, it's because they're terrified. So we just need to get better education out there to help them snorkel, if it's possible to get them to snorkel in water without reef first. That may be a better idea, just to get their fins right. That's something that we've thought of, but right now I think what we do have the power to do is increase the educational load. Yeah.
I think maybe what he's talking about is establishing new areas.
As alternatives. As
alternatives, yeah.
I don't think that that has been discussed yet.
Do you have a scale for this state?
So each of these cages are 1 meter by 1 meter, and here is 4 meters by 4 meters. So these safety pool lines block off a 4 meter by 4 meter area, which relative to the bay is not that large. It has no entering signs all around it in several different languages. We have these full cages within the research zone, a partial cage within the research zone, and then these non-cages. What these are is they're just marked. The corners are marked with tiny little pins that are going to get overgrown with crusted squirrel and algae so quick that no one will know they're there, except for us. And even so, sometimes I'll swim over them and never find them. They'll still take me 10 minutes. Looking a little more into this, why do we have all these cage types? Inside the research zone here, we have full cages which exclude humans and fish. We want to see what the benthic substrate is going to look like if we don't have any humans, and we also don't have any herbivores. Are we going to get high algal growth, or what's going to be going on with the corals that are present within these cages? We then have these partial cages here, which allow fish feeding, but do not allow humans to enter. And then we have these non-cage treatments out here that have both the influence of humans and fish. What are we looking at inside each of the cage? We're trying to look at how it differs in the amount of algae and coral, the health of the coral, coral growth and mortality, and coral improvement. So those are some of the things that we'll be doing this year. In at the same time, we'll be looking at fish. Yes.
So how deep are the cages? Do they ever, are they going to ever in one time be above?
Yes. Water? But so is the reef flat. So at a very low low, the reef flat is exposed, so the cages will also be exposed.
So yes. How are the cages going to be?
They are anchored with metal stakes. So they get a metal stake put in, and then there's going to be a PVC slip over it, and then metal siding and top.
The PVC is for safety?
Correct.
Okay, because in the previous chart of the passage study was where the research has injured on the anchor of the exclusion cage. So your laceration, which if you open into lawsuit,
yes, we have been talking with the Office of Coastal and Conservation Land, and they have already approved the permits for this, but it does say that if anyone does get injured, or even if it's not working out, let's say it's a big wave action day like today, and the cages get toppled over by waves, we're prepared.
How will you look at the possibility that the center of the cages may attract people to the non-cage areas and increase the traffic?
The non-cage areas?
Right. If they can see these on the surface.
That is a very good question. The non-cage areas are randomly selected on the outside and not always are on one side. They're pretty dispersed throughout, so we're hoping that the traffic will not be as heavy. I think we just did the best that we could with randomization. Yeah.
How often do you plan to monitor these sites daily?
On Tuesdays, we'll definitely be monitoring them, but also one day a week I will be here at the beach desk to answer any questions, to also do repairs if needed.
How many installations like this in Spain? I'm sorry.
There will be one in each major sector of Bay.
What factors went into deciding the size of the square and then the size of the full pages? A meter square is pretty small. And if it, if 1 meter square has a vertical area or lots of rugosity, that'll more likely show growth than one that doesn't have rugosity.
Right?
So the selection of that 1 meter square is vital to the results. If, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
So actually,
okay,
we just went through all of this with OCPL. So planning the witches group page, which we'll be putting in first. And what I did is I had to submit all of my GPS points to them ahead of time, but once I went out there to look at where the GPS points actually were and map out the cages, what I noticed is that the substrate was not continuous. It wasn't the same in this cage versus this cage,
yeah,
or the non-cage.
Yeah.
Right, so what we did is we took new GPS points and submitted that to OCCL, and they were okay with the change.
But there's no way of assuring that the 1 meter square are typical of that 4 meter square, and there's no way of assuring that the 4 meter square is typical of the whole sector. Right?
Exactly, that's field work.
Yeah, no, I understand.
Yeah.
I understand, no, I don't mean to pester you, it's just
no,
that.
All we could really do is make sure that our substrate composition within each of these treatments were similar.
Yeah.
So that's the best that we can do.
Yeah, no, I understand the problems.
Yeah. Yeah.
Well, do we have to have a second video or an announcement that the anybody has to listen to before we go in the water?
There will be more signage. So we're
going to
place a sign for this out there. And then we're going to have a sign for this out there. And I have been working with the education staff to see whether or not they're going to put out a sign within that room. And then we're also going to have a flip book down at the beach to talk more about it.
You have to keep people away from it. You have to help.
Yeah. And then it also has all of these signs around the outside that
help. You enjoy your announcements when you attract more people to these places and then keep people away.
Well, then we can just change our question.
I just put a shark sign over there.
That's right.
Shark
cage.
Yeah,
right.
That's the height, or did I miss
it's
that?
It's 10 inches, or 10 centimeters, I'm sorry. So it doesn't have to be very high, because we're just excluding humans and herbivores. So they aren't very high off the substrate, it's just for coral cover. And for here, a lot of our coral in Hanauma Bay is encrusting or lobing is shallower. None of these have large colonies in them. It's mostly small colonies that we can track to growth rate that over time, and no coral will be harmful putting in the cages. Yes.
So is there going to be a study that's going alongside of this with the water quality?
Water quality is very expensive. So maybe when we get more money, we could do more water quality. I would love to. The Department of Health actually comes and does some water quality. That's great. And we would love to. The first caring capacity study did some water quality. And they found normal levels of nitrate and phosphate in the inner reef. They did find some elevated within the inner reef, so where there were more people, but it wasn't outside of an unhealthy range. And then they also looked at turbidity, kind of what we did with the secundus, and they found the same thing. The further you go from shore, the less turbid the water is, the less cloudy it is.
equation between here.
I wish that I had the visual for that. So in 2014-15, during that bleaching event, the coral reef ecology lab looked at coral bleaching in the inner reef flat here, and they actually put out little floats everywhere, and they used GPS points to follow them so that they could look at the water circulation in the inner reef flat. And what they found is that there's a little gyre over by Witch's Brew area that just kind of circulates. That's why in the summer months it feels pretty warm, whereas by channel or back doors where those big channels have been dredged out, we get a little more water flow.
I just want to say I think you're doing a great job on the study. It's way overdue. Thank you.
Thanks, Ron. And thank you to all of the volunteers. Thank you so much. And City and County Sea Grant Education Program and Friends of Hanauma Bay and the Coral Reef Ecology Lab for that. Yes.
I wanted to echo that, Sarah. You and your team and your group of volunteers have done a phenomenal job. And so we, all of us in this room, support this. We know it needs to be done. And we hope that you continue, you and Kuumei continue with the project for us. So thank you very much.
And I just want to say we're very grateful for your input. So any concerns that you have, we welcome those so we can either make adjustments or try to explain what our reasoning is.
Can I ask a question that you might like to leave the next?
Of course.
We have a graph to find out. The new rate, we have coral coverage in the deep and shallow location. In the last 8 years or so, or 6 years, what's the basic, for the dark, the deep one, it started up under the last one. What caused the increase in coverage? With a little bit of a black one and a green one, which is quite good. What caused it?
What caused the increase in coral coverage?
In coral coverage.
Kula, do you have any ideas?
We didn't do surveys over here. So what you're seeing here, where you see the dots, you see one in 2002. You don't see another one until 2012. So this is 10 years of growth, and that's why you see a very large increase. And we had expected that decline in the shallow sites. We had not expected the increase. We had also expected that decrease, but it looks like it got to a level where the corals could maintain the level of coral cover that they were at. And so that's why you see that decrease after 2012. All the sites in the state were done in 2012, so they're comparable. But then we had the 2014-15 bleaching event, and almost all of our sites in the state showed a decline, like you see at our deep site here. But it did not happen at the shallow site, and I believe that is because of the circulation that Sarah talked about earlier in the bay, where you see Witch's Brew area having a lot more circulation in that area, so you're getting cooler waters in that area.
Just looking at the last part of the graphs and the increase, is she seeing that it's the circulation that caused it?
The increase just between 2017 and 2018?
I asked the question, what caused it? And the only thing I heard was circulation.
The increase between 17 and 18?
And the last part, both of them do that, right?
Yes.
What caused it?
That could be just normal coral growth
after the decline.
Right.
So throughout the state, there was a heavy decline of certain species. We had a 35% die-off throughout the state from the bleaching. And in Hanauma Bay, we had a
really, really high temperature waters.
Temperature.
Yes, temperature was really high during this. That caused this decline that you're seeing here. So then after that, you're seeing the increase after the water's cooled down. Temperature.
What kind of confidence level do you have in each of those points?
We have a pretty high confidence level. I'm glad you asked that. But because we
I don't see it on there.
Yeah. seal. We have 10 transects at each of these, so there's 20 transects total. But at Hanauma Bay, they weren't done every year, like I say. But at every one of our 70 sites throughout the state, we have 10 transects. And when you do it over time, that boosts your power for analysis. So we have a pretty high statistical power. We can detect coral cover within about 5%.
Nice to know there's not a single snapshot.
Yes, it's not. We took 1 year in 1998, and we did nothing but look at what the best methodology would be in order to do this, because there was no integrated system in the entire state that looked at monitoring. And so this was the first and only monitoring system in the state that was integrated. And so we spent an entire year working out how many transects, how many points on each transect, how many areas, what the homogeneity or heterogeneity of the areas would be, and how we would deal with that. And after we design the system, it is able to detect within 5%. Thanks for asking that.
I can appreciate your data points about that.
I appreciate you asking.
I also want to say thank you. It's to you and all your volunteers. It's a lot of work doing this, but it's also a lot of planning and logic and execution. I also want to ask, or maybe say, and then ask, for a few of us here, we swim early in the morning, right? You know, I'm one of those people. And there's a lot of people, depending on the time of year, who come in here, you know, before 7 a.m. And, you know, in the summer, it's crazy. A lot of people, English is not their first language, as you know. And, you know, when we come back, you know, a number of us swim all the way out. We come back into the bay, into the inner reef. So many people walking on everything. And they're not comfortable snorkelers. And I think that group of people really needs to be addressed.
I completely agree with you. Yeah, hopefully adding more signage there in several different languages will help that as much as we can.
I know that as friends of Hanauma Bay, we talked about having, you know, something like videos or something in different languages to help people understand how to actually snorkel.
Yeah, I think that's a
because
big idea.
Because it might be their first time, or, you know.
Or the majority.
But whatever, you know, I appreciate the people outside who are talking, but they're also speaking in English.
Yeah.
And those.
And sometimes there are crowds that
they're
speaking to.
Yeah. And we have to help explain to them how to snorkel. So there need to be a big, giant step forward to help those people feel comfortable and understand that the thing you're stepping on is actually some little creature's home.
Right. I completely agree. And I promise that we are working
toward
it.
We're happy to help.
Good to know.
I think one last piece of this puzzle is the tourist industry that is benefiting financially from all the people that are coming to all these places. And they need to be part of the solution as far as educating the people that they're bringing here, as well as just financially. You know, helping with the signage, helping with the studies, helping with everything we need to make these places sustainable. And they're just sitting out there pocketing all the money while we're struggling to try and keep these places looking nice or sustainable. So let them pocket up the money.
Yes,
Sarah, I think, you know, you may have to consider using buoys to delineate. This is where you swim and delineate the channel area where the sand is, the keyhole, rope that thing off. So that's the buoys are here, you can swim in this area, you can swim in the Rockies area. It's so shallow anyway. If you can't, life pressure, you can't go over there. That's just the easiest way to control it. So rather than more education, more videos, and more staff, it's just easier.
Yeah, it would be easier.
Clear cut.
I think we can try try to work towards something like that. I know that it takes a lot of permitting. I spent a year doing the permits for these stages, and it's not just the Office of Coastal and Conservation Lands that you have to go through for that. It's the Division of Aquatic Resources. It's a lot of different agencies that we have to talk to about something like that.
I think that works. Down in St. Croix, it works. I am in and out of the reef. A lot of coral, a lot of fish. I got a buoy to float around it. You can look into the area, but you can't swim over. It seems to keep the place alive. I would like to thank you for the study, and I would like to thank all the fish. That makes it a beautiful place to fish.
I agree with you.
I have one more suggestion. You know, a lot of times when we're out, and I don't mean, you know, us who's all the way out, but it's really hard to hear the lifeguards. And they're speaking English. So I know there's going to be times when they're going to say, you know, don't go around those big areas. So there really needs to be some money helping the lifeguards out, because it's hard to hear them, even though they've got, you know, those loudspeakers. It's still hard to hear them. And possibly help them in some other languages.
I completely agree with you.
Yeah, I just have a question related to the woman's question about something about the coral breakage and the amount of use in a certain area. I look at this not so much from a human point of view, but from the science of it. And your cages are your silver bullet, is the way I see it. If you want to convince people that humans are damaging the reef, your experiment with the cages are the way to go. That is it. So my suggestion would be, could you at all increase the sample size? In other words, have more full cages. Because four in an area, the sample size of four doesn't get you very far statistically. I'm just throwing it out. I mean, you probably have thought about these things before, but I'm just, again, I see it as, if you want to convince the tourism board, or the state legislator, whatever, whoever, that the people are damaging the reef, you need evidence, you need data, and you need data that's collected in a good way. And somebody might say, well, you only have four, even if they don't know anything about, you know, a t-test or a NOVA or whatever, they might say, well, four plots isn't very many, right? And I'm just suggesting you probably talk about it, of boosting the number. It gives you greater strength, obviously, right?
Yes,
so
definitely anyway, we've talked about it.
It's probably not easy, because people probably don't want you to put cages out at all in the bay, I suspect. I have no idea.
Right. It's difficult because we're getting some backlash for the cages, but they are an eyesore, right? They're not going to look beautiful, but they're going to tell us what we need to know. Mm-hmm. And so we're working with the sample size that we're getting.
Yeah, no, I understand.
Done power analyses with prior data to see in other areas to see what the sample size should be, and it would be wonderful to have more replication. One way we're thinking of doing this, and others have done in other areas, is to do it across time. That way you have it in different months or in different years, and then this data can be pooled if other things are similar.
Yeah. So for the four full cages, do you have four non-cage areas too?
Correct.
Okay.
There are four full cages
for each sector.
Yes.
Okay.
Do you know what you do?
Yes.
Yeah.
All the time, except for maybe on days that are this way.
Thank you, Sarah.